Hey everybody, it's Scott Weather here, back with another Capture One tutorial. And today we're going to talk about the new Dehaze filter, but not like everybody else is, because I shoot people in a studio, not landscapes. So what will Dehaze do for me? And that's kind of the question I ask myself. So I've been torturing the control for the last couple weeks now, and I want to show you what I've discovered. So before we get started, let's talk a bit about this channel. So if you're new to this channel, I do a lot of Photoshop post-production, painting, all kinds of weird stuff, but I like to torture this product the most. It's the one that I use for the majority of my business, and you'll always find weird and interesting tutorials that are hopefully practical as well as super technical. I like to go a little bit deeper than everybody else is and do something different. All right, so today let's talk about torturing this control. So I have Angela here, who, by the way, is going to be in the studio this Saturday, as well as Haley. We're going to be doing an Ask Me Anything with those two ladies. If you'd like to talk to them and ask them some questions, we'll be on Discord, and I'll be recording that here to show on the channel. Now, the first thing about the Dehaze filter is trying to figure out where I want it in my workflow. So I think most landscape photographers will put it here in the lens area. So what I'm trying to do is say my workflow starts here and ends over here. I would normally have it here. I think most people would, but I'm going to try and put it in here. And the reason I'm putting it in my colorizing or color grading area is this is where I have found it to be most useful for me. So let's talk about what it appears to be doing. So by default, it comes up with this automatic, and what that does is allow you to remove kind of gray, it's almost acting like an overlay blending mode, although we don't have blending modes in Capture One. I wish we did. It's kind of what it does. And then this side, it appears to do something else, like kind of muddying the colors. So what can we do with this? How is it useful? I found two things that I think are pretty cool. So the first one is, let's just pick like a medium skin tone. So I'm going to go for something on her cheek here. Now, if I go and add this direction, it's going to add the complementary color. So it's getting a green two areas of the skin that have that same kind of range, I think. I mean, it just appears to do, well, whatever it does, it's horrible. But it is adding that range to the image. How can we make this useful? Well, that way, not so much. But this way is adding a nice little color grade to the image. Now, it does matter how bright the value of the color you pick is. So if we go for something like on her forehead here, that's going to be a lot different look than if you go for something, say, in the darkest areas of her hair. So you have a really nice, interesting opportunity to find, say, a happy artistic accident and introduce it into your image. Now, maybe I don't want it over the entire image, but I like what it does in the shadows of her face here. So let's play with it that way. To do that, let's reset this. Let's reset this, and then we're going to create a new filled adjustment layer, and we're going to grab again that same kind of color up in here and introduce that same situation we had a moment ago. But now I have a mask, and I can use luma range, and this is where I get kind of fun. We'll go display the mask, push this all the way this way, and then what we're going to do is we're going to tighten this up so that it's only displaying in the shadow areas, and then this is the feather into the rest of it, so something like this. And now what we've done is we've created a situation where that luma range change is tightening in where the dehaze is occurring. So we have the opportunity to kind of add an interesting color cast and lift into the shadow areas of the image. And I think that's pretty interesting. Again, we're looking at how to solve problems in our imagery. And this is just another one of those tools I'm going to add to the tool chest. So pretty interesting. Not sure that it's everything I want it to be on this image, but it's pretty cool. Now, the other thing that I found, we'll get rid of that, is let's create another new filled adjustment layer for this one. And if you find other ancillary colors in the image, like say this purple here, again, it depends on the saturation and value of that purple, meaning how dark or how light. I think this middle range here would be good. I actually wish that you could adjust this color, but Capture One doesn't allow you to change the color right now. So I've actually created kind of a cheat sheet of different colors, and I can pick from there and then come back and modify an image. But I haven't really found a better way to do that yet. But in this case, I'm picking that kind of purpley color and then pushing it this way to add that softness of that purple tone over this whole image. I'm not really sure what you would call that. It's kind of a blending mode-y kind of look. I mean, not too much, but just a little bit. And I think especially in boudoir or bridal imagery, this softness is really pleasant. Could I have done it with this tool? Yeah, probably. But would I have wandered across it? Not likely, right? This kind of creates that freedom for artistic expression that maybe we don't expect. And those are the best kinds of things for me, because it's that happy accident that leads to a new piece of art and an unplanned adventure. And that's exactly the kind of rabbit hole that I like to explore. So once again, thanks for watching the channel here. Everybody, your support has been amazing and I really appreciate it. Again, if you'd like to join the channel, I invite you to click the join button down below. There's lots of little things down there. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up so that the rest of the world can see it.